My dear children and parishioners, you know that today is what is referred to as the titular feast, meaning the feast of the title of our parish, of our school, and also of our religious congregation. So it is a very important feast day, and of course it honors the title of our Blessed Mother as Queen, Mary Immaculate Queen, Queen of Heaven and Earth, Queen over all creation. And we can go back to find the roots of this title of Our Lady even in the Old Testament. It's interesting, we have a couple of feast days of Our Blessed Mother in which the epistle is taken from the Book of Wisdom. And the writing is concerning wisdom, but it states, I was there with him from the beginning when he created heaven and earth and so forth. And you think, well, why does the church apply that to Our Lady? Because she didn't exist when God created the world. But in another sense, she did. She existed in the mind of God. He knew that he was going to create her. And so we might say, in a sense, she was a queen even before she was created. And to demonstrate that, let us look at that wonderful promise and prophecy made by God himself as recorded in the third chapter of the book of Genesis. And that was when Adam and Eve had fallen into sin, the original sin. God said to the serpent, he said, I will put enmities between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed, and she shall crush thy head. So Our Lady crushing the head of the serpent shows a dominion that she has authority. And so again, that leads us to her queenship. But in today's gospel, we read the gospel from the Annunciation. And it's interesting, the final couple of verses of this gospel, the angel is telling our Blessed Mother that she will have a child, and thou shalt call his name Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of David his father, and he shall reign in the house of Jacob forever. Now it had been prophesied to King David that his throne, his kingdom would last forever. But how would that be? We know that the Jewish nation was conquered by the Romans, and the descendants of David, no one even knows anymore. But his kingship lives on in our Lord, because our Lord was from the family, from the line of David, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. Now, if the angel was telling our Blessed Mother that she would have this son who's going to be this king, and of his kingdom there shall be no end, then quite obviously she is a queen, the mother of a king, and such a king. But we also see this in the writings of the fathers of the church and the doctors. And one of them that has always astounded me is quoted by St. Louis Marie de Montfort in his book True Devotion, and I believe it is St. Bonaventure. But St. Louis quotes this doctor, the church, as saying, all things, Mary included, are subject to the empire of God. And all things, God included, are subject to the empire of Mary. That's an incredible thought, that our Blessed Mother has so great a dominion or a queenship that everything and everyone is under her dominion. Even God is pleased to fulfill her requests. And St. Louis goes on to say that our Lord never refuses a request of Our Lady. First of all, because she would not ask something that is against the immutable will of God. For instance, Our Lady wouldn't ask for one of the damned to be released from hell, because that cannot be. Or something else that is contrary to the eternal decrees and immutable will of God. So Our Lady would never ask something like that. And therefore, our Lord will always grant her requests because he is pleased to, you might say, to repay his mother for all that she did for him during his mortal life, and also because of her great holiness, her obedience, her humility. Our Lord delights in granting her requests. And that's why St. Bonaventure could say those words, which at first glance seem to be almost disrespectful, but they're not. And he says, all things, even God, are subject to the empire of man. Here's a doctor of the church saying this, but we have to understand it in the right sense, that God is pleased to fulfill the requests. And this should therefore increase our confidence when we go to Our Lady, that if we gain her intercession for us, then we can gain all the graces we need to save our souls. It is like that wonderful prayer of St. Bernard called the Memorare. Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to thy protection, etc., etc., was left unaided. It's impossible that someone would go to our Blessed Mother with a humble heart, with a sincere heart, beg for help, and be refused. She is not only a queen, she also has a heart full of kindness and love and mercy and gentleness, that she will not cast us off if we turn to her. So let us pray on this feast of our Blessed Mother that our confidence in her intercession will grow by leaps and bounds. We should have not the slightest doubt that our Blessed Mother will come to our aid if we approach her as we should, with a humble heart, with a fervent prayer and petition, with an earnest desire of what we ask, and at the same time, with making an effort to conquer sin in our lives and to live in a manner pleasing to her, because that is especially what pleases her, our Queen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.